Techniques of Ivar. I will be dealing with historical background, characteristics of abdominal aortic stent grafts, anesthesia, access and imaging, Ivar deployment and Ivar troubleshooting. Coming to the historical background, Walters and colleagues performed the first stent graft repair of an aortic pathology in 1987. In 1980s, Walters and et al. And Parodi et al. Introduced endovascular treatment of abdominal aortic aneurysm with a device composed of a Dacron graft and a balloon expandable stent. Coming to the characteristics of abdominal aortic stent grafts, coming to the fixation is to inhibit the distal migration from the sealed zone after deployment of the stent. Factors which increases the endograft susceptibility to distal migration. Which augmented the vector forces increases the risk of component suppression and even proximal migration. Then aortic remodeling, which after EVAR can also result in morphological changes and cause stent graft component suppression. Coming to the positive fixation, describes the use of metal hooks, barbs, anchors, or supplemental staples to attach the graft to the aortic wall and prevent migration. Column support in endografts with stents that run along the full length of the device, which helps maintain the position of the cranial end of the device in place by straddling the aortic bifurcation for buttressed stability. The friction is the outward radial force of the stents themselves creates friction with the vessel wall that can reduce migration. Sealing. The seal zone adjuvants include covered flares that expands beyond the nominal diameter of the main graft, which are polyester fuzz, sealing cups, and off-labeled stent utilization. The basic steel stent pattern of the seal zone of the device has a large impact on both sealing and conformability, which are critical factors for treating angulated necks. The scallop depth of the graft material at the cranial margin of the device also determines the effective required seal zone of the device. Coming to the sizing, EVAR stent grafts comes in a wide range of aortic diameters, iliac limb diameters, and the graft length that are labeled for varying arterial diameters and angulations. The complexity of case planning varies with each system because of different in sizing windows, techniques, tapering zones, and usable seal zones. The endograft should be oversized 10 to 20% in comparison to the aortic neck. Currently, the EVAR devices ranges from diameter of 18 to 36 mm and can accommodate aortic diameter of 16 to 32 millimeters. The risk of excessive oversizing are less obvious. However, bench testing has demonstrated that oversizing greater than 20% creates pleating of the fabric. We can see in the figure with a black arrow mark. This pleating of the fabric can lead to endoleak. Type 1 endoleak. Coming to the graft material, usually the graft material must be strong enough to resist the late deterioration and damage which is caused by the metallic part of the stent, and it should be thin enough to be compressed in a small delivery catheter. Conventional polyester has been preferred in most stent grafts. PTFE is an alternative graft material used in excluder endograft and power link endograft. Other materials such as polycarbonate, polyurethane, and other polymers are under investigation. Coming to the radio opacity, delivery systems and stent grafts have radio opaque markers to facilitate rotational orientation, deployment, and gate cannulation. Such markers vary with each graft, and not all are positioned in the same position with respect to the graft's fabric edge, which is not itself radio opaque. Some markers are circumferential, whereas others are positioned intermittently around the circumference of the device. Coming to the deployment precision and ease of use, The deployment components vary in flexibility, trackability, valve function, outer diameter of the ipsilateral and contralateral sheaths, number of times that a large sheath must be inserted, and the deployment precision. The labeling, torque responsiveness, need for exchange length wires, a difficulty in cannulation of the contralateral gate or snaring a contralateral wire, and all contribute to the complexity of the deployment sequence with each respective graft. Detailed knowledge of sizing, deployment techniques, failure modes, expected outcomes, and re-intervention techniques is essential to provide a durable endovascular result. Difficult iliac anatomy can often be treated with smaller systems or those featuring deployment systems with a high degree of flexibility and trackability. Severely angulated short aortic necks are well treated with orthopedic but more flexible investigational devices, and off-label aortic stents can potentially overcome challenging proximal necks. Coming to the less angulated short necks may be addressed with branched or fenestrated devices or snorkel or chimney adjuvants. In this picture, we are showing two techniques. For some patients with proximal infrarenal neck length less than 15 millimeter, partial renal artery coverage with adjunctive renal artery stenting can be performed using either the encroachment technique or the snorkel technique. In encroachment technique, where the superior margin of the stent graft is pushed inferiorly by the renal stent, and in the snorkel technique is used when there is a complete coverage of the renal artery origin is required to achieve a seal. This for the snorkel technique, a transbrachial access is the key for this maneuver, and for encroachment technique, the transfemoral approach will be sufficient. Coming to the selection of a stent graft, the characteristics of the ideal stent grafts, like low overall cost and the user friendliness, like column strength, sealing capacity, radio opacity, low thrombogenicity, lowest delivery device profile, and delivery device reliability, and excellent apposition of graft. Coming to the individual aortic stents, Hook Zenith Flex, which is made up of the woven polyester, and the stent material is made up of stainless steel. The treatable aortic neck range from 18 to 32 mm. The treatable iliac artery ranges from 7.5 to 20. The proximal fixation here comes is the suprarenal. The unique features are it is a partial proximal repositioning with shortened Z stents of main body, and limb inhibits migration and kinking. Coming to the gore excluder, which the graft material used here is EPTFE with the stent material of nitinol. With the unique feature is being the repositionable proximal delivery system, which allows multiple attempts to achieve accurate proximal landing. Coming to the Medtronic Endurant graft stents, this is made up of the woven polyester with nitinol as the stent material, which has the proximal suprarenal fixation. The unique feature is the three-piece system, which allows flexible in situ end sizing, approved to treat 10 mm proximal neck length. Coming to the endologic AFX, the unique feature here is the unibody component provides anatomical fixation on aortic bifurcation. Coming to the trivascular ovation with a graft material of EPTFE with the stent material of nitinol, which has a suprarenal fixation with the smallest delivery sheath profile, that is 14 French, proximal sealing ring expanded with polymer in bio. Lombard orthophix with the unique feature of ability to treat aortic neck with angulations of 60 to 90 degree. Coming to the patient selections, the patients with these features are in more favor of are the good candidates for EVER this one, the procedure. The patient with a proximal aortic neck who has a cylindrical neck and at least 15 mm in length measured from the renal arteries, The diameter of 33 millimeter or less is preferred. Then neck angulation, there is the angle between the infrarenal aorta and the neck of the aneurysm. The angle should be less than 60 degree. And coming to the distal landing zone, the aortic bifurcation should be large enough to accommodate both limbs of the bifurcated stent graft. The diameter should be more than 22 millimeter. The maximal iliac artery diameter must be at least 2 mm smaller than the largest limb size available. The length of distal landing zone is 10 to 15 mm. A mural thrombus in the neck more than 90 degrees is considered a risk factor for endoleak, whereas extended calcification increases the probability of stent migration. These are the unfavorable anatomical characteristics with CT angiograph morphological findings related to the proximal aortic aneurysm neck, aneurysm sac, that the residual lumen less than 18 mm, distal aortic diameter less than 20 mm, and involvement of the common iliac arteries. Coming to the iliofemoral vessels with unfavorable anatomical characteristics, the common iliac diameter more than 25 millimeter, landing zone length less than 10 mm, external iliac artery diameter less than 6 mm, and tortuosity more than 90 degree. And if there is an anterior calcification of more than 50% of the circumference of the femoral access site. Going to the preoperative imaging, the imaging technique of choice for EVAR is high quality contrast enhanced computed tomographic angiography. The maximum recommended slice diameter is 2.5 mm for standard devices. Sizing for fenestrated or branched devices requires less than 1 mm cuts. The next picture shows the schematic of abdominal aortic aneurysm measurements for stent graft sizing. The letter A shows the length of the neck of the aneurysm. B is the length of the aneurysm itself, and the C is the distance between the bifurcation and the internal iliac artery. Then we have other measurements like D1, D2, and D3, and concerned with the common iliac like D4, D4B. Preoperative imaging, curved linear reformants can be used for accurate assessment of the diameter and length of the potential attachment zones in the aorta and iliac arteries. In this picture, the picture A shows with axial scanning of an angulated infrarenal neck, the neck may appear elliptical. The assessment of the largest diameter includes overestimation of the real diameter in concern to the diameter. When in concern to the length, with axial scanning, the length of the infrarenal neck, that is L1, includes an underestimation of the real length, which is more than the L1, that is L2. Coming to the anesthesia, it is mainly based on comorbidities and the body habits. Ideal to control the patient's respiration either by vocal instructions or by control with the ventilator. General anesthesia is appropriate of choice in when we are planning for iliofemoral conduit. Regional or GA is favored by most operators when an open vascular access is required. Coming to the percutaneous access, shorter procedure. The advantages of percutaneous access are shorter procedure time, less postoperative pain, and a lower the risk of wound complications. The disadvantages being increased hospital cost and the occasional need for urgent conversion to an open repair. The percutaneous access is possible for sheath size up to 24 French. The relative contraindications for percutaneous access in EVAR are severely scarred groin, high femoral bifurcation, need for frequent introducer sheath changes, significant proximal iliac occlusive disease, small iliofemoral arteries, and anterior calcific femoral disease. Coming to the open access, it can be either a vertical or a oblique skin incision. The advantage of vertical incision is the ease of gaining additional exposure to the iliac and femoral vessels. The advantage of oblique incision is the wound problems are less frequent, and it is useful in morbidly obese patients. access in the iliac occlusive disease. The iliac vessels should be carefully studied preoperatively with CT angiogram. In cases of focal iliac occlusive disease, balloon angioplasty immediately prior to the endograft insertion should be done. Bare metal stents should not be placed initially. The hydrophilic cones dilators can be effective in dilating longer segments of occlusive disease. Internal endoconduit, placing a covered stent in the external iliac vessel, which is then aggressively angioplastized to the required diameter of 9 to 12 mm. Recently, a balloon expandable sheath has become available to help in accessing the smaller iliac arteries. This is the suggested position of operating team members and equipments related to ER. Coming to the steps in the stent graft introduction is, in figure A, we can show the groin cut down, and figure B, the introduction of the stent graft, positioning of the main body of the endograft in proximally to renal arteries, and a pictile catheter at the level of the renal arteries via the contralateral iliac artery. Then coming to the deployment of the main body and opening of the contralateral gate, the pictile catheter is moved down into the aneurysm sac before deployment. Then the pictile catheter is exchanged for an angled multipurpose catheter, and the contralateral gate is cannulated. After cannulation of the contralateral gate and exchange for stiff wire, the contralateral limb of the graft is deployed, and the ballooning of the proximal and distal seal zones and graft overlap junctions is performed. Coming to the EVOT deployment, the wire placement after bilateral open or percutaneous femoralosis is achieved, a floppy J wire should be placed in the proximal thoracic aorta and exchanged over a catheter for a stiff guide wire. Through the contralateral femoralosis, a pictile catheter is then placed just above the renal arteries at the level of L1 and L2 vertebral bodies. If there is a concern about iliac occlusive disease, an angiogram should be done by keeping the catheter at the level of aortic bifurcation. If there is uncertainty regarding the correct main body length, to select an aortogram with 1 cm grade marker catheter can be performed to confirm the distance between the lowest renal artery and the ipsilateral hypogastric artery origin. The delivery of the main device, the contralateral gate or the limb of the main device should be appropriately oriented by fluoroscopic evaluation prior to insertion. If the endograft is not advancing smoothly, the first step is to change to an extra stiff fiber, such as the Lenderpist. Rarely, an external manipulation of the distal aortoiliac segment may be beneficial. If these maneuvers are not successful, the use of a buddy wire should be considered. Going to the proximal endograft deployment, after the main device is placed in the pararenal aorta and the contralateral gate, limb position is satisfactory. The gantry of the fluoroscopic unit is adjusted with the appropriate amount of cranial and oblique angulation. A magnified view should be utilized with the lowest renal artery in the center of the screen and proximal graft marker position verified to minimize the parallax errors. It is essential to visualize both the renal arteries. The endograft should then be slowly pulled down until the proximal extent of the device fabric sits immediately below the lowest renal artery. After the proximal landing zone of the endograft is established, deployment of the endograft continues until the contralateral gate is deployed. After deployment of the bare suprarenal stent, no further movement of the main device is possible. An exception to this principle is found with the C3 extruder endograft. Contralateral gate cannulation and limb deployment. The most important step is planning appropriate gate orientation for favorable cannulation. Retrograde cannulation of the gate should be possible in more than 95% of the cases. Rarely, the contralateral gate cannot be cannulated in retrograde fashion despite utilization of the maneuvers. Failure to cannulate is usually the result of gate not opening adequately because of small distal aortic neck, an eccentric calcific distal aortic reef, or an extremely tortuosity. In such a situation, the gate should be cannulated in an anti-gate fashion, usually via the brachial access. Several maneuvers will speed cannulation of the gate. That is, one may be the after retrieving the pigtail or other angiographic catheter, avoid pulling the wire back into the iliac artery. There is a severe tortuosity or a narrow distal aortic neck. It can occasionally be challenging to regain access to the aneurysm sac. Once a wire is negotiated through the gate in an anti-grade fashion, above, is snared in the respective iliac artery and withdrawn from the corresponding femoral access sheath, then over a catheter, the wire can be exchanged for typical retrograde deployment. If all attempts to gate cannulation are unsuccessful, the final bailout technique is a conversion of a bifurcated device into iliac configuration with the creation of a femtofem crossover. This maneuver will be needed in less than 1% of cases. Coming to the completion arteriography, the use of power injector with an injection rate of 15 cc per second and a total contrast volume of 30 cc is recommended. Because the large sheath size of devices will frequently reduce iliac, these should be routinely aspirated with the 20 cc syringes during the injection. Image acquisition should continue for a minimum of 5 seconds after the contrast of the iliac arteries has washed out to allow visualization of the late type 2 endoleaks. One should confirm the patency of the renal and hypogastric arteries in the completion arteriography and to assess the precision of the proximal and distal endograft landing zone position and to evaluate for unsuspected occlusive external iliac disease. Stiff fires will occasionally cause the tortuous iliac artery to occur in, which is seen in the figure, in which there won't be any stenosis, but in radiologically it shows there is a severe stenosis. It feels like it is having a severe stenosis, and one should also look for access for the endoleak. Coming to the tips and tricks for troubleshooting problems, coming to the access, small caliber and are severely diseased iliac arteries. In these cases, gentle dilatation with the balloon or preferably with dilators may overcome the problem. In cases of iliofemoral graft prior to endovascular aneurysm repair to facilitate the access, in which a 8 mm Dacron tube graft can be used as a conduit. Coming to the severe angulation of the iliac artery, in this picture, when there is a severe angulation is there, this is called as a parody technique, which is in which the surgeon's left hand with the index finger is used to pull the external iliac artery, and the catheterization is done through the right hand. In cases of internal iliac artery involvement, the graft limbs are extended into the external iliac artery in 15 to 30% of cases. Retrograde flow from the internal iliac artery tributaries into the aneurysm causing endoleak. Internal iliac artery occlusion causing buttock or colonic or pelvic ischemia, in which internal iliac artery translocation to the distal external iliac artery, or a bypass graft from the common iliac to internal iliac artery can be done. Angulated proximal necks. Severe neck angulation may preclude endovascular repair. However, if the neck is long enough, it is possible to straighten an angulated neck with a large palmar stent, either before or after the stent graft deployment. Excessive angulation or tortuosity can also be straightened by the use of two stiff wires prior to stent deployment. This is a picture showing figure A. We can see the short aortic neck immediately before endovascular aneurysm repair. In type B shows type 1 year endo leak after initial endograft placement and molding balloon angioplasty. Figure C shows the resolution of the type 1A endo leak after placement of a giant Palmer's stent. In the troubleshooting in cases of short limb catheterization, that is a snare technique. In this picture, the contralateral limb can occasionally be technically challenging, particularly if the short limb is not fully open and compressed by aneurysm thrombus, or when the axis of the common iliac artery is not with aligned with the graft. In those cases, snaring a wire from the opposite side should be considered. The wire is caught below the orifice of the contralateral limb with a snare goose neck catheter and withdrawn from the introducer. This is exchanged for a stiff wire, the limb of the graft prepared as before. Coming to the limb or graft occlusion, open conversion with a femorofemoral or axillobifemoral graft may be performed. Though open graft thrombectomy and correction of any recognized technical defect should be considered. Rupture. When rupture occurs before stent deployment, prompt
the bleeding.
What graft is placed tail injury. To gain immediate control, a balloon can be inflated to isolate the artery injuries. Definition of treatment in case of aneurysm.
ಅಲ್ಲ ಬಟ್ ಈವಾಗ ನೋಡ್ತಾರೆ ಎಲ್ಲಾರು
ಹೀಗೆ ಪಟ್ಲಾಸಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಪಚ್ಚ ಇದಾಗ್ತದೆ ಮೊದಲು ಪಟ್ಲಾ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಬೆಡ್ ಹಾಕಲಾರು ಇಲ್ಲ
ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಟೇನ
ಗೋ ಆನ್ ಗೋ ಆನ್.